The most important slide that I have in the presentation is the one right before the conclusion. So that's the one that I will probably talk the most about. So we'll see about that. And that one is definitely one that gives a lot of, I guess, new impressions. Sven already did a great job introducing myself. And I don't really have anything to add to that. So let me start by getting right into it. So if you look at Wikipedia, what Wikipedia says is that software architecture are the high-level structures of your system. And they basically say, well, the structure are the software elements, relations among them, and properties of elements and relations. And that is why we get all these boxes and arrows diagrams that basically say there are some elements and they somehow relate to one another. That's basically it. Oh, by the way, I should have mentioned that if you have any questions, feel free to ask them right away in the chat. So I do some streaming. So doing some presentation while looking at the chat and trying to see what kind of questions I can answer. That's what I'm used to. So if you look at what Martin Fowler said, Martin Fowler said that software architecture are the important and hard to change decisions. And that's another take on software architecture, but it doesn't really talk about architecture either. So I would say that architects actually do architecture and technology, and there is no need to care about organization. So there is, let's say, some problem here. And one thing that, of course, says that you do have to care about organization is Conway's law, the famous law that has already been mentioned several times in the conference. And that law says that the architecture copies the communication structure of the organization that builds that architecture. So it basically says that organization and architecture are more or less one, so that the one thing is basically the other thing. But really what it says in a way is that once you have the organization, the architecture will copy that. So it basically says that your organization goes first, and then you have the architecture as a sort of an artifact that is generated by the organization. And to point that out more clearly, here is the organization. So I have some team here, I have another team here, and then I have a third team here. And if I have those teams, they will probably build some module, because modules by definitions are things that can be implemented independently from one another. So the idea is that a module has some interface and some internal workings, and you can change the internal workings without changing the interface. So you will negotiate the interface, but not the internals. And you will work on one module to keep the communication between the teams low. And that means once you have set up this organization, you will actually get these modules. And that's a problem, because usually you might end up with teams that have some specialists for some technology, like a UI specialist, specialist for backend technology, another specialist for databases. And that means you will end up with three layers, three artifacts, and changes will probably go through these artifacts, and therefore your software will be, well, not hard to change. But if you do want to have some change, it will probably go through a lot of teams and a lot of modules, and that's not the best idea. And it will cause a lot of communication between it, because those teams have to talk to one another. So that is why there is this other idea that basically says, once we have the architecture, we create the organization from that. And that's the inverse Conway maneuver that originates in the microservices world. And James Lewis, who gave the keynote, is sort of the person that got this started. So in that case, you will start and say, okay, here are some modules. This is the architecture that I want to have, the software elements and their relation. And now I take those modules and I give each of these modules to some team that will work on it. And that way you will enforce the architecture. So it basically means that you can do architecture work quite differently. So I started and said that architects do architecture, and that seems to be the obvious truth. But what you could also do is you could say, here is a team, here's another team, here's a third team. You care about order processing, and you can, if you have some requirements, you might forward those requirements to the shipping team. So order processing can actually give requirements to shipping. And then there is invoicing, the third team. And that in a way means that order processing is the priority. So order processing is more important, and they can tell shipping that they have some requirement, and shipping will eventually implement them. So this is obviously more important than shipping, because they can give requirements to that team, but not the other way around. So teams will build modules then, and that means each of these teams will create a module. So you have created an architecture this way. And these modules might be bounded context from domain-driven design. And what I just introduced is a way to use organization as a tool for architecture is the customer-supplier relationship. That's another part of domain-driven design. So this idea that some team gives some requirements to other teams, that's what's called customer-supplier. And it is actually about putting the priority on the customer side, on the team that can give requirements to the other team. So that means, in a way, these basic ideas about how organization and architecture are closely related, it originates from Conway's Law from 1967. It is something that the inverse Conway maneuver in 2012 used as a way to build an architecture. And finally, there is domain-driven design that also talks about this quite a lot, that has been started in 2004. So if you agree to this, then there are some specific challenges, some specific things in that regard. So first of all, the organization must be defined. I would argue if you have a large group of people, you will split them into teams. You will create some organization and define how people would work with one another. And that is also the coarse grained architecture. So once you've set up the organization, you've actually made a decision about the architecture too. So that's interesting. And it is something that you can't choose not to do. You have to do it. You have to set up the organization, and there will be this influence. On the other hand, there are the managers, and managers usually work on organizations. So setting up teams, giving them some mission, that is what managers usually do. So if organization is architecture, then the question arises whether architects are actually managers, or the other way around, whether managers are also architects. So it means, on the one hand, if some manager decides that these are the teams that should work on the project, they have actually made an architecture decision. And on the other hand, me as an architect, I would actually want to set up an organization. Probably I can't, because I'm not a manager. And there is an interesting misunderstanding here, actually, because what Conway's Law actually really says is that the architecture copies the communication structures. So far, we have spoken about the organizational chart, the org chart, and our teams are set up, let's say, on paper. But there are people in an organization that talk to one another, even though they are not related if you look at the organizational chart. Actually, you have just witnessed that, because me and Sven, I don't think that we are on some relation on some organizational chart, but we are in the same organization at InnoCure, and we just talk to one another. So this is really about communication. It's not about the org chart. So if you say that architecture is more like communication, then it's actually not about the org chart, and you can start to use a different tool, which is communication, not organization. So one of the things that you can start to do now is you can make sure that the right people talk to one another. So for example, we've spoken about the interface negotiations. That is something that you can try to set up to make sure that specific teams talk to one another if they have some interface, or also other decisions, technology decisions, all these kinds of things, because that is actually what architecture is. So you could start to support a community of practice, for example, for front end or for architecture, because there are specific decisions that should be made for front end. It is one of the tricky parts of the project. So you make sure that there are communication infrastructures to tackle that risk. And I would argue that you probably don't need a manager for that. Some architect who starts a community of practice for architecture doesn't seem like something that is out of scope for an architect. So that is something that I actually started doing in one of the last projects together with the architecture team there. And one of the lessons that I learned from one of the Scrum Masters there is that if you set up such a community of practice for architecture, for example, it's not necessarily the content that you have to set. So it's not about you pushing through your agenda on each of these meetings. It is rather that you're building a tool for communication for other people, and the content will follow. So that means that people will raise the problems that they have. That will make sure that you work on the right things. And that means that it's not necessary for you to come up with all the decisions and push them through. As an architect, I find that also quite interesting because usually I'm sort of on this 10,000 feet perspective, where there are so many details that I don't even see them, and it's about coarse grained decisions. And talking to people who are more into the details and who are basically on the ground helps me to understand those details, and it also helps me to communicate architecture decisions and challenges, get some feedback, and make sure that I actually work on the right stuff, on the most important stuff. So that is why such a community of practice about specific challenges in your project might be a very good idea. However, still, there's a problem. So if I look at this really coarse-grained architecture, there is a lot of stuff that I don't really see and that I'm not sure how people are doing the architecture in there, how they're making decisions, and so on. And it's a very basic challenge of software engineering. The systems that we are building are too complex for human to understand. So it's impossible for me to look into all of these modules and make sure that they are designed, that the design is sound and all of these things. And if I was a traditional architect, then the architect would decide everything. And at one point, the architect would be overloaded. And I cannot possibly know all of the details. It's a dead race. So if I have 10 engineers coding all the time, and I'm just one architect, there is no way that I can keep up on the detail level with what those 10 people are creating all the time. Still, I do have some ideas that I want to introduce to that organization, like microservices, domain-driven design, and whatever there is. So how do I do that? And Sven said that, so I do have an expertise on microservices. I do have some expertise on domain-driven design. So obviously there is the question, how do I make that expertise usable to my clients as a consultant or to other people when I'm in an architecture role? And the obvious solution seems to be to just do it. You know, here is some cool architecture. This is according to domain-driven design. Here are the bounded contexts. Here are the relations like customer-supplier. This is it. You just have to implement it. Great, right? So it's all done for you. And you just have to use the plan that I made that is so obviously great. So here is some diagram that I might have created. And the interesting problem is that this is probably the wrong way to do things. So there is this really interesting book called Accelerate by Nicole Forsgren. So she is a scientist holding a PhD, has done some work on empirical studies on software engineering. That's actually what this book is about. It's about some studies that they did and that they evaluated. Jess Humble, who wrote the original continuous delivery book, and Gene Kim, who wrote the DevOps guide, among other books. And what this Accelerate book says, what they found out using those empiric studies, is that the discussions often focus on tools and technologies such as, should I adopt microservices? Should I do serverless? Should I do Kubernetes? Should I do Mesos? And what they found out is that those are actually the wrong questions to focus on. So if I go somewhere and I'm called in to do some microservice adoption, maybe that's not really the question at hand. And they continue to say that the tools are actually irrelevant. Tools such as microservices or domain-driven design, they don't mention domain-driven design. So tools such as microservices or Kubernetes, they are irrelevant if people hate them and they don't achieve the outcomes that we need and they don't enable the behaviors we care about. So what are the outcomes that we want to achieve and what are the behaviors that we do care about? So what is important is to enable teams to make their products and services without depending on other teams and or systems. So that means if I go there and say, this is the architecture, that's probably the wrong way to do it. We should enable the teams to come up with a solution by themselves without depending on me, on other teams, on architects, and that is basically what we should be focusing on. Maybe it's just about other teams as in peer teams, but I think even if you are as an architect, there is still this influence and you should probably rather not use it. So what should I do? Well, we must enable others. And what I sort of, so if I look at some team member, I actually look, in my opinion, at an expert. So as a consultant, I usually go somewhere and there are people and they have some expertise. Maybe I'm the person who has the best understanding about microservices, having written a few books about it, but I'm certainly not the expert on the domain logic, for example. And I'm certainly also not the expert on the details of the existing system. And I might not be the expert on specific technologies. And that is why we need to enable others and try to make sure that they make the right decisions because they are the experts. And the best sort of metaphor that I can come up with are collaborative games. And I'm afraid that the game that to me is sort of the best example of a collaborative game is Pandemic. It's a game about trying to get rid of a pandemic. So I'm sorry about that example, but it is really the best collaborative game that I can. So I just saw in the tweet the reminder about the pandemic. Exactly, that's why I have a little bit of that's why I need to come up with a different example. But whatever. So a collaborative game is a game where all lose and win together, and that's how IT projects should also work. And what is so now? You might wonder why would I even play that game? Because obviously it's not about me winning over the others. So these games are interesting because everyone has a specific role. So the person here on the very front, she is a scientist, and she has an easy, for her, it's easier to find some cures for some diseases. And the guy right behind her, that's the medic, So he can cure people who are already infected. And I think the person here in the background is a logistic person, and he can make sure that people are moved around the world quicker. So what this is about is communication. So it's about, you know, can you put me, the scientist, somewhere else so I can do X? Oh, no, we should rather put the medic there to cure some people. And so you talk all the time about what the different roles should do. And it's about a communication and coordination and collaboration. And that is what that makes it so interesting, because it's not about your turn. It's about all of you discussing what you should be doing in your turn. And that is why I think it's probably more important to make some project successful to enable this kind of communication, and probably not focus too much on architecture itself. So as soon as I start drawing that diagram, I actually draw that diagram. I could spend the same effort on enabling others to do that work. And if they do, then they can add their expertise to that. So they can add their expertise to the diagram, and they probably have a better buy-in to whatever I've come up with. If there is a finished diagram and I show it to some people, it's something that I've come up with, not something that they have come up with. So how do you do that? And that's another interesting point. And again, it is something that sort of talks about what I'm doing at customer sites these days. So first of all, if you have something like domain-driven design, it's important to get the concepts in the head of the people, so to make sure that they understand it. So you can start by, well, trainings. But I would argue that it's not enough. So you could start by saying, okay, I want to spread some knowledge about whatever it is that my expertise is about. But actually, what you really want to do is you want to make sure that people actually use that knowledge. And that's a different thing. So we know that there is the climate catastrophe. We just fail to work on it. So it's not about the knowledge. It's about us not being able, as humanity, not being able to work on it. And we probably all also know what we should be doing. So that is a different goal. And if you want to have some workshop that makes sure that people actually do act on the problems and actually do use the knowledge, they are probably should probably be different. So how are they different? Well, first of all, you need to invite quite diverse roles, because there are so many different stakeholders: developers, QA, ops, management. And in a traditional training, you would just provide some knowledge. But as I said, that's not enough. So getting the ideas into their heads is not enough. You have to do something different. And that is why we copied that concept of kata and dojos from martial arts, that is also common for software development. And the goal of such a kata or dojo is to create something like this example here. That's a DDD architecture, and not to have too much content. So it's more like 5 slides for 5 hours or even less. Sometimes we don't use slides at all. So it's not a lot of content. I can easily talk about 5 slides in 10 minutes or so. So it's not so hard to talk about the content, but they actually do it. And afterwards, they have done it. So it's more likely that they actually will do it in the future. And to make sure that they really, really do that, you can add some reflection to the end of your dojo or kata. So how are you going to use that tomorrow? What are the obstacles? And you can collect post-its, or you can put that on some mural board, so on virtual post-its. You can discuss that. So there are quite a few different ways how you can discuss that. And that way, you get them to think about changing their behavior, but you also learn about the obstacles that there might be, such as for domain-driven design, there might be some reasons why they are not doing that. So that is one way to do such workshops. And as I said, I think that's quite an important tool. However, after you've done that, they will probably try to use it on their real-world problems. And they only have basic knowledge now. So they have done it with one example. They will try it. They will probably run into some challenges, and you will need to provide some consulting or support. And I would argue that obviously one training is not enough for people to actually change and do things differently. So it's important to support them later on. That is something that I do at a few customers. However, there are obviously a lot of customers that just book one training. And yeah, I'm wondering how they support people who actually want to use that knowledge afterwards. And these things also give opportunities to for other possibilities. So, for example, you can have a workshop. So someone has a challenge. So, for example, it's not clear how to design a specific part of the system using domain-driven design, bounded context, and so on. So you can make that a dojo too, or a kata. So you can take that example and have a group of people working on it. So you could write down the challenge and then have them work on it. That has some advantages. So people would actually use that new technique. They would therefore spread the knowledge about the technique. They will talk to one another. They will make sure that their results are better and sound and actually work. But you will also spread the knowledge about the challenge and about decisions. So we have said this part of the system will be designed in this way because of these facts. Oh, wow, that's usable. That's quite an important information, because I never knew that they had these challenges. And now I can do these things in my module, in my team differently. And also it will strengthen collaboration, because we are working on some problem together. With the customer where I've done that, there was one challenge, that is, it takes some effort to prepare that. So maybe you want to try different things like open spaces that we are trying with a different customer right now, where you set up, it's basically a day or half a day where people come, you set up an agenda at the beginning of the day, and then there are groups discussing different topics, so problems that they might have run on and things like that. Or you could try to make those workshops more ad hoc. I mean, there are people who actually do understand the problem. Maybe it's enough to have them talk to the groups and have the group work on that problem afterwards. So these are different tools. I would argue that you will probably run in culture issues. So because there are these collaborations between IT experts, domain experts, management, and so on. So the culture problems will surface. There are some, I would argue, surprising things there. So one thing that I ran into was, we basically said, so the team that I was working with basically said, here's a new idea, like domain-driven design. And we presented that idea, and then some team was sort of ordered to follow that idea. And they came to us and said, well, just tell us how we are supposed to work. Just give us some concrete rules. And this sounds great, right? It basically means whatever you say, we are going to do that. But it's really not. I think there is a lack of buy-in there. If they really buy into the idea, there would be questions like, oh, I don't understand that. And can you please explain that? And have you thought about this? And maybe we should do this, because then things will work better. So that's different. They would try to improve the idea. And therefore, there is a problem here, which is maybe not that obvious, which is we have to collaborate. We actually have to have common goals, and we have to win together, like in those collaborative games. other problems that you might run into. So I would argue that you have to support business goals. And one problem that I actually did run into was, why would I share our secret business strategy with the architects? Well, because I want to understand how I'm supposed to help and how I'm supposed to support that. But that was a problem there, because they thought that we might not want that this information is just off limits. Maybe the most important cultural issue, and that's what I started talking about, that's what I said in the beginning, this is probably the most important slide, is that social organizations are not deterministic. Computers, I've been told computers are deterministic, I'm not sure anymore, but social organizations are certainly not. So what I've said so far, so I've been talking about the Conway maneuver, for example, where you would change the org chart and you expect the communication to be different afterwards. That's basically what it says, right? You're changing the org chart and then the communication should be different because then the architecture is different. That can obviously fail because people might ignore that reorg. It wouldn't be the first reorg where people say, yeah, it's great that we have this new org chart, I don't care. And in some cases, it might even be the case that this reorg will be reversed after a while because people don't follow that reorg. And it goes on. So I've basically explained a very logical way how you can make some people use a technique like domain-driven design by explaining it to them, by doing some workshops, by making sure that they understand that, by making sure that they are supported on all of these things. But that might not work because social organizations are not deterministic. And it might just be that you're the wrong guy or the wrong person, I should say, that it's not the right time, that there is some piece missing. And maybe, and that's probably the worst thing of all, after some time, the same thing might work. I've done an interview, I'm afraid in German, with another colleague of mine not too long ago, and he used the word irritating. So he said that basically what you're doing is you're irritating the organization. You're basically sort of throwing stones at it and saying, okay, here's a workshop. Maybe they will follow the ideas in that workshop, and that might not work. And irritating to me is a good expression for that. You're basically giving some input, and it's not obvious how the organization will behave. And I think that's also an important part that is missing with the inverse Conway maneuver. It always sounds like it's a very rational, deterministic thing, but we all probably know that such reorgs are not that way. So in conclusion, I just like the sentence. I would argue that architects shouldn't do architecture. They should probably do, there are a lot of other things that might be more important and that might cause an architecture to sort of appear or to facilitate the architecture process. So you might define teams, as I said, because that's close to defining the architecture. You might establish communication to support the architecture. Training, consulting, dojos, cutters might help you to set up the fine-grained architecture. And I'm always reminded about this sentence here. We are uncovering better ways of developing software by doing it and helping others do it. That's the first sentence of the Agile Manifesto. And it's basically, maybe it should be something like the categorical imperative for software engineering and for software architects to make sure that this happens and that people are following these ideas. If you enjoyed the presentation, please do send an email to this email address. You will get a link to the Dropbox that includes the slides, some free publications that I did, and sample chapters from the other publications. That's an Amazon Lambda script and some small microservice. So the data privacy note is your email address will be locked for 14 days. And if you have a typo in your email address, I will handle it manually.